So hi guys, my name is Mansi Anand and I welcome you to this series called RBI 24/7. So guys, as most of you would be knowing that in this series, we discuss some finance and economics current affairs that can be of use to you if you are preparing for competitive exams. So we are going to discuss 5 questions, and before moving to question number 1, I would like to ask you guys to subscribe to our channel. So if you are a new entrant here and you're watching our video for the very first time, then do not forget to hit the subscribe button, because it is going to connect you guys to us. And don't forget to press this bell icon, because it can help you to get notified whenever a new video comes up, right? So are you guys ready for question number 1? And before moving to question number 1, I would like to ask you to subscribe to our Telegram channel. On this group, you can post all your doubts and queries, and we'll try to get back to you as soon as possible. Okay, so here is your question number 1 for today, which says the Dash makes an application for registration of the mutual fund and contributes at least 40% of the net worth of the AMC, right? So here are your 5 options. You have to select the correct option. And the correct option for this question is option D, that means sponsor. So guys, here we are talking about mutual funds. Now there are many entities involved in a mutual fund, in the operation of a mutual fund, right? So we are going to learn about them. So you can look at this diagram. This diagram is going to help you to understand. First of all, on the top, there is a sponsor. So sponsor, you can say, the sponsor person or the sponsor entity is like promoter. Just as we have promoters in companies who lay down the foundation of the company and who are basically the owners of the company, similar goes for sponsor, the business owner or the owner of the mutual fund, that is the sponsor. So sponsor has the job of getting the mutual fund registered and contributing to the capital, right? So as you can see in the question, the sponsor contributes at least 40%, right? After that, we come to trustee. So now who is trustee? Trustee is an entity after sponsor. So trustee, you can understand it as top management or board of directors. Basically, trustees are there to look or supervise however the mutual fund is getting managed, if it is getting managed according to the laws or not, or the organization, the fund is following all the norms of the regulators or not. So basically, they have the supervisory job, just like board of directors do in a company. Similar job is performed by trustees in the structure of a mutual fund. After that, we come to AMC, or the asset management company. So they are the managers of mutual fund. Basically, they have to look after the day-to-day operations or day-to-day processes or the schemes in which the money is going to be invested. So basically, they are the managers, right? So I hope the structure is clear to you. First sponsor, then trustee, after that AMC, right? So business owner, registration and capital. After that, trustees, they perform the job of supervision, and AMC, they perform the job of management, right? So here you can look at some other entities associated. Depository, it is like a warehouse for the safekeeping of the securities or the assets in which the mutual fund has invested. After that, registrar has the job of registering the fund. After that, transfer agent basically looks after the transaction. See, all the unit holders who are going to invest in this mutual fund, units have to be distributed to them and money has to be taken from them. And whenever there is some sort of reward or there is some dividend announced, that has to be transferred to the unit holders. So whatever are the transactions that take place with the unit holders, transfer agent keeps a track of that. After that, auditor. I think we all are familiar with the term auditor. Auditor looks after the entire process, that whether every there are no accounting loopholes, or the records which are being maintained, the accounting records, the financial records, on the basis of which the investor is making the informed decision, those records, they are proper, they are not mismanaged, or there is no fault, or they are not tampered to give a false impression, right? So I hope now you are clear with this structure. Moving ahead, here you can see the eligibility requirements for being a fund sponsor. So an entity who wants to sponsor a mutual fund has to follow this criteria. First of all, the sponsor must have experience in financial service for a minimum of 5 years, with a positive net worth for all the previous 5 years. So basic, first, experience in financial service for 5 years, in which they have been profitable, they have had a positive net worth, that means their assets exceed their liabilities. After that, net worth in the immediate last year has to be greater than the capital contribution of AMC. So whatever capital is being contributed to AMC, the immediate last year's profit. So in the year in which the sponsor wants to establish that fund, the year preceding to that, in that year, the worth, net worth, should be greater than the capital contribution. So whatever capital contribution has been made to the AMC, net worth should be greater than that. After that, sponsor must show profits in at least 3 out of 5 years, which includes the last year as well. So mandatory in the last year and 3 out of 5 years. Sponsor must have at least 40% share in the net worth of the asset management company. So guys, these sponsors, they are usually huge financial institutions like banks and financial companies, right? So moving ahead to the second question. Okay, here is our second question for today. This question talks about something called a family settlement deed. Okay, before moving ahead with this question, guys, I would like to ask you here, sponsor. Okay, so this term has been in news in relation to some acquisition deal that is being going on in the, that is being published in newspaper. So you have to read Mint and let me know that which is that deal that I am talking about, like, right? So I'll be waiting for your answers in the comments. Okay, moving ahead. So here is your second question, talks about family settlement deed. Three statements given to you and you have to tell that which is the incorrect one, right? So guys, there is a little bit of correction in question. You have to select the correct ones. Okay, so this is the correct question. You have to select the correct ones, right? Three statements given to you, select the correct one regarding family settlement deed. Moving ahead. Okay, the correct option is option C. Option C means only three is the correct statement. It is not mandatory to register it legally. So these two statements are not correct. So guys, family settlement deed, as the name itself tells you, that it talks about some transactions that are going on in a family, right? So a family settlement deed talks about how the assets of a family are going to be distributed, so that there is no dispute in the family regarding distribution, right? Okay, you can see here, some families want to settle property disputes out of court. They do not want, so wherever there is some big business family or there are some assets in the family due to which there are some sort of conflicts and they want to settle it out of court, then they can go for this family settlement agreement or deed, in which they can decide how they are going to distribute the property. So to this effect, they can go for a family settlement agreement, which needs to be signed by all the members acknowledging that this agreement wasn't made through fraudulent means, force and coercion from any family member, right? So agreement must mention the names of all family members. Here, in that statement, it was written Okay, as you can see in statement it was written that it should mention the name of all the members who are above the age of 60, whereas it should mention the names of all the family members who are concerned with the matter in regard and details of ownership of the property and specific terms of this distribution of the said property, right? Very simple, and it's better if the deed also talks about the features of the property, or if there is some business, then what are the characteristics, or if there is some property, then what is the size, the location, right? So it is easier to have details noted down. So it is recommended that you include all the details of property with house number, area, even a site map if possible. Family settlement agreement can be orally conveyed or in a written format is recommended because it helps to avoid any confusion. So basically it is not mandatory to register it legally, but obviously it is advised so that it has a legal identification, and so that it becomes easier in future to deal with such sort of transactions. Not just property or immovable assets, shares, claims, family feuds are also areas where a family settlement agreement is useful, right? Okay, moving ahead to the next question. So here is your third question for today, which is, look at the following statement. It here refers to dash. Two statements given to you, you have to identify what is the meaning of it here, right? So it allows customers a limited period of interest-free loan, and it allows consumers to delay payment or pay by installments, right? Moving ahead to the solution. And the solution says that the correct option is option E. Option E means buy now, pay later, or popularly known as BNPL. So this is one term, one model which is being talked about a lot in newspapers. So if you have been reading newspapers regularly, you must be aware of this system. So see guys, this is a very old system, and we Indians are aware of this system. So if you talk to your grandparents or your parents, who if they are in accounting field, they must know something about something called khata, which means account, right? So this is an old system which has been practiced in India, where customers, they buy something from a shop or they buy something from a seller, but they do not pay every time they buy. Rather, they fix a time and they pay according to that duration. Let's say if you purchase, let's take a commodity which has to be bought daily. Let's say milk. If there is a nearby shop and you buy milk from that shop regularly, then sometimes it becomes really irritating to pay regularly or to pay every time you go to that shop. Rather, you know, you have to buy milk daily from that shop. So you can set that you are going to pay that shop weekly, right? So whatever is the bill for the week, you settle it on weekdays, you settle it on weekend, right? So it becomes easier to transact. So same is the system with buy now, pay later. Only difference is that this is digitized, and here we are not talking about any shopkeeper, but we are talking about the e-commerce firms or e-commerce companies who sell products, online products and services, and indulge into the system of known as buy now, pay later. So they are allowing their customers to order and settle the bill or the amount for the entire order in one go, rather than paying every time they order, right? So that is what BNPL is. So this provides customers a limited period of interest free loan. So going back to the example of milk, so let's say you have made a system that you are going to pay your nearby shop every Sunday, because Sunday is a holiday and you have time that day, right? So you go to that shop every Sunday and pay your bill. But let's say on one Sunday you went somewhere and you couldn't go and settle your bill, right? So the shopkeeper give you 2 days grace, Monday and Tuesday. Now if you settle the bill within these 2 days, then he is not going to charge anything extra. But if you're not able to do this, if you're not able to settle your bill within these 2 days, then the shopkeeper is going to charge you with a penalty of, let's say, rupees 100, right? Because obviously he has to wait longer than what has been decided in your mutual agreement or mutual decision, right? So same goes with that. These e-commerce site, they provide some time to their customers to pay their bill, and if they pay their bills, they settle their dues within that stipulated time, then no interest is charged. That is why I provide a limited period of interest-free loans. But if customers are not able to settle that, then they have to pay interest, right? Allows customers to delay payment or pay by installments. So this is very popular. If you have been shopping online, then you must be aware of it, right? Moving ahead, here you can see BNPL is trending with customers, consumers, investors and regulators worldwide. BNPL generally defined as payment service that allows consumers to delay payment or pay by installments. For regulators, a clear distinction of the product is that does not charge any interest to the consumer for the use of credit. So this can easily spiral out of control as tracking spending and repayments becomes convoluted and difficult. So this might seem like a really good system, and obviously it is easy because, see, one point here which differentiates BNPL with the installments or with the loan with mortgage is that the main purpose here is not to finance your purchase. Because see, if you are paying for milk on Sundays, here your purpose is not to save money, because obviously if you you must be having the money to pay for milk on a daily basis, right? So it is not that you do not have the financial capability to pay for it, but the purpose here is to ease out the transactions or to bring to make the transactions hassle free or swift or quicker in nature, right? So same goes here. The main purpose or the main utility which the consumer is seeking is ease. But they are not looking to finance the product. It can be a purpose in some cases, but the main purpose here is to have hassle-free transactions. So in India, many a times we face problems in online payment. There can be network issues, or the payment doesn't go to the seller, but it gets deducted from your account. So there can be many errors. So if you are going to pay a huge amount in one go rather than paying in smaller amounts frequently, then it is going to be easier for you. So that ease, that convenience is what the customer is seeking here, right? So apart from that, financing can be a secondary reason. So this might seem like a very good system, but it can spiral out of control, because if the consumer is not able to settle their transactions, their bill amount on time, then they have to pay higher interest rates, right? So this is what the company is counting on. The company is counting on for you to default so that they can put some late penalty, right? Consumers often seek a superior frictionless one-tap checkout experience and buyer protection. So I hope now you understand about BNPL. Moving ahead to the next question for today. And the fourth question, it says, Dash are the companies that strive for social benefit as well as profit. Very simple question. Moving ahead to the solution. The solution says that the correct option is option C. Option C means impact enterprises. So impact enterprises, it means an enterprise which is having a positive impact on the society, but they are not non-profit. They are for-profit organizations. So they seek both purposes, being for profit and apart from that having a positive impact on societies. So they are called impact enterprises, right? Okay, impacting investing to generate specific business beneficial social or environmental effects in addition to financial gain. So both purposes being fulfilled here. point of impact investing is to use money and investment capital for positive social results. So here we are looking to combine both the purposes rather than just going for social benefit or facing losses. But here the purpose of the organization is to generate profit and simultaneously have a positive impact. So it can span a number of industries including healthcare, education, energy, agriculture. So basic goal of impact investing is to reduce negative impacts of business activity. So we all know that many a times business activities, they have such negative effects on environment. They throw garbage or their waste into rivers, they pollute the air, they emit some harmful gases which can create pollution, which can lead to diseases. So there are a lot of environmental hazards related to business activities. So this impact investing, it tends to mitigate those negative impacts, right? Impact investment sometimes be considered as an extension of philanthropy, but here the companies, the management is not looking to pay out of their own pocket but to generate profit simultaneously in a sustainable way, right? Moving ahead to the next question, here is your next question, which says in international relations, dash refers to an alliance of multiple countries pursuing a common goal. A very simple question, this term is very popular in newspapers. Moving ahead to the solution, and the solution says that the correct option is option C. Option C means multilateralism. So multilateralism, what does it mean? So you can judge from its name, multi, and it says alliance of multiple countries using a common goal. So multilateralism is a concept which combines the interest or integrates the interest of different entities. And in case of international relations, we are talking about many countries who are trying to integrate their goals to have a collective benefit, right? That is multilateralism. You can understand it by many countries coming together and then trying to take some initiatives. So if we talk about the pandemic, COVID-19, it is something that all the countries in the world, at least most of the countries in the world are suffering, right? So they need to combine their efforts rather than doing something good for them and creating trouble for others. It is better if they come together and integrate their goals. So that is multilateralism, in contradiction to a concept called unilateralism, which means looking for your own benefit, and multilateralism looking for the collective good, right? So see, this term has been in news because of COVID-19 pandemic, as I just told you, because it has to be a collective effort by the countries of the countries so that they can come out of this recession which is COVID induced, right? Recently S.J. Shankar, he gave a statement that multilateralism, when it was needed the most, it failed to prove positive, or it failed to do good for the society, right? So it has been in news. Moving ahead, see, using this concept of multilateralism, the multilateral development banks have been set up. So these are development banks, or these are financial institutions who work for the upliftment of all the countries in a collective way. So multilateralism is a concept to give power or to give voice to the smaller countries of the world as well, right? Serves to bind powerful nations, discourage unilateralism, give small powers or small nations a voice, influence that they could not otherwise exercise. For a small power to influence a great power, the Lilliputian strategy of small countries banding together to collectively bind a larger world can be effective. Now discussing the second point. So I hope most of you are aware of the story of Gulliver Travels. Most of you would have had read the book of Gulliver Travels, in which the main protagonist lands into a city where everyone is very small in size, right? So we're not going into the discussions of the book here. So Lilliput was the country where everyone was very small in size, but they can amplify their power if they combine together. So that is the Lilliputian strategy for smaller countries of the world, that if they want to raise their voice, if they want to fulfill their interests, so it is better for them to come together so that their voice, their power can amplify by combining, right? So this is the, so multilateralism is a basis for this concept, so that smaller countries of the world can be given power. Multilateralism may allow one great power to influence another great power. So do you see a balance here, that if one great power or one huge country tries to dominate the other smaller countries, another great power can stop it or has the power to oppose it, right? So to create a balance amongst different entities holding power. So multilateral banks, development banks based on this concept only. As you can see here in the picture, many banks, World Bank, Asian Development Bank, etc. After that, owners of MDB are national government and other international institutions and organizations. So obviously there is much criticism and there are doubts about the working of these banks, that whether they actually work for the upliftment of smaller countries or not. But we are not going into the politics of it. The basis or the foundation is based on this concept of multilateralism, right? So guys, these were the 5 questions for today. I hope you learned something new from this video. And if you did, then do not forget to give us a thumbs up. So before ending the session, I would like to take some doubts. There was a question by Shivani Sharma. Okay, Shivani is asking that I told you in a session that depreciating country leads to, okay, if there is a country whose currency is depreciating or falling in value, then it leads to higher exports, right? And simultaneously, it was told by Anuj sir in one session that increasing exports appreciate a currency, right? So Shivani, these statements, they are not contradictory, they both are correct in their own sense. See, what you are trying to do is you are trying to reverse the statement, that if depreciation leads to higher exports, higher export must mean depreciation. Don't do that, because the cause and effect relationship is different. In first case, what I told you was that the cause is depreciation. See, if the value of a country's currency is falling, then obviously your goods, let's say if India's rupee depreciates, then if someone sitting in America orders someone from India, that product become cheaper to an American customer. That is why higher exports take place, right? So the cause is depreciating currency and the result is higher export. Whereas what Anuj sir told you in that, the cause is increasing exports. See, this is a mechanism. You can connect both of them also, that if a country's currency is depreciating, that leads to higher exports. Then when the exports rise, that means increasing exports, that means foreign customers, since they are finding your goods cheaper, then they are demanding more of your currency, then they are demanding more products in your currency, which in turn appreciates your currency or reverses this process, right? So what I told you, cause depreciating currency resulting higher result, higher exports. What sir told you, cause was increasing exports and result appreciating currency. So do you see, it's a mechanism that how this depreciation is itself countered by increase in currency and the balance is restored, right? So we both told you different parts of it. You can combine it in this way, right? I hope your doubt is cleared. And this is a general thing, that in economics, don't try to reverse it, because cause and effect can be different, right? So you cannot just reverse the relationship, right? I hope it is clear to you. Okay, after that, there was one comment by Prashant. Prashant was asking why increasing forex is not good for India. See, increasing forex reserve, that means RBI is trying to buy assets in foreign currency. That is why it is leading to increase in forex. So that means that RBI is increasing or RBI is leading to rise in demand for foreign currency that can lead to depreciation of Indian currency, right? See, one thing can have some positive impacts and some bad impacts. Having accumulation of forex reserves can be good for a country, but if a central bank buys too much of it, then it can lead to depreciation of your own currency because you're supplying your currency and buying foreign currency, right? So in that way, that can be one aspect. Now we have to look at the situation of a country, that whether the result is good for us or not. RBI, okay, if we talk about the current situation, RBI was buying forex from quite some time to keep Indian currency depreciated, not too much, but at a level, or to prevent it from appreciating, because we were getting a lot of foreign investment. So to prevent Indian currency from appreciating, they were buying forex reserves. But they stopped doing it when they realized that we do not want Indian currency to depreciate further. So they put a halt to their forex buying, right? Or they allowed Indian currency, Indian rupee, to appreciate so that they can counter imported inflation. So guys, this all mechanism was discussed in a video. If you want the link for it, Prashant, you can ask for that video's link, right? Okay. Okay, so guys, these were two doubts that I had to clear, right? So I'll see you in the next session. I hope you guys got your doubt clear, Prashant and Shivani. And I'll see you in the next session. Till then, you take care of yourself. Keep your studies going on. And thank you for being here.